December 18th, a great day for the Constitution of the United States, a sad one for America that the President's reckless activities necessitated us, our having to introduce articles of impeachment. May I thank our six chairs who for a long period of time have been legislating, investigating, and litigating. Today, that came to a culmination on the floor of the House with the Judiciary Committee under the leadership of Jerry Nadler of New York and the Intelligence Committee under the leadership of Adam Schiff of California brought the articles of impeachment to the floor to a conclusion where they have passed. I thank them for their tremendous leadership. I thank Chairwoman Maxine Waters of California, of the Financial Services Committee, Richie Neal of Massachusetts, the chair of the Ways and Means Committee, Carolyn Maloney, the chair of the Government Oversight Committee, and of course, Adam Schiff, the chair of the Intelligence Committee, for their great work over a period of time. I just want to say before yielding to the chairman that I could not be prouder or more inspired than by the moral courage of the House Democrats. We never asked one of them how they were going to vote. We never whipped this vote. We saw the vote. Well, you saw the public statements that some of them made. We saw the result when everyone else did. The statements on the floor about patriotism and about being very true to the vision of our founders. And so I view this day, this vote, as something that we did to honor the vision of our founders to establish a republic, the sacrifice of our men and women in uniform to defend our democracy and that republic, and the aspirations of our children that they will always live in a democracy and that we have tried to do everything we can to make sure that that is their reality. We'll hear from our chairman and then we'll take three questions. I'm now honored to yield with great appreciation and respect to distinguished chair of the Judiciary Committee, Chairman Nadler.
Thank you. The framers reserved the power of impeachment for the gravest offenses against our Constitution, against our liberty, and against our democratic institutions. President Trump used the powers of his office for his own personal political gain to the detriment of the national security interests of the United States. That is the very definition of an impeachable offense. When Congress began to investigate President Trump's wrongdoing, he engaged in an unprecedented pattern of obstruction. That, too, is why the impeachment power exists. A president who subverts both our elections and our constitutional system of checks and balances puts himself above the law, and it is Congress' duty to hold the president, any president, accountable. It gives us no pleasure to stand here today, but President Trump's conduct has put our next election at risk. President Trump's behavior puts the integrity of our constitutional order at risk, and President Trump's continued actions put the rule of law at risk. The framers gave us the power of impeachment for exactly this reason, and in fulfillment of our oath and obligation to the American people, today we took action to hold President Trump accountable for the serious and undisputed risk he poses to our free and fair elections and to the separation of powers that safeguards our liberty. A president must not be allowed to become a dictator. I want to thank Speaker Pelosi, Chairman Schiff, my fellow investigative chairs, and all of my colleagues who today defended the principles upon which our nation was established. Today, the House of Representatives did its constitutional duty. Today, we lived up to our responsibility to the American people by taking action to defend our national security, to preserve our democratic elections, and to show that no one, not even the president, is above the law. And now I'm now happy to introduce the chairman of the Intelligence Committee, Adam Schiff.
The President of the United States has been impeached for now only the third time in history. The President of the United States should be tried. And the question is now whether Senator McConnell will allow a fair trial in the Senate, whether the majority leader will allow a trial that involves witnesses and testimony and documents, a trial that should be fair to the president, yes, but should be fair also to the American people. The American people want to hear from people like John Bolton. The American people want to hear from people like Mick Mulvaney. The American people want to see what's in those documents that the president has been hiding at the State Department, in the Office of Management and Budget, in the White House itself. We have done our duty here in the House. We have upheld the Constitution. We have done as the framers would have us do when a president abuses his office and obstructs a co-equal branch of government. The question now is, will the Senate uphold its duty? Will the senators uphold their oath? Do the senators want to hear from the witnesses? Do they want a real trial? We have to hope that they do. The reason we undertook this extraordinary step is because the president not only abused his office, but threatens to abuse it again, threatens to interfere again by inviting foreign interference in our election. The remedy isn't complete as long as the president is free to continue to invite foreign interference in our affairs. I just want to close by thanking the Speaker for guiding the Congress through this tumultuous time. There's no one, I think, who could have guided the Congress with a steadier hand or with more insight and intellect than the Speaker of the House. And I also want to thank my colleagues, in particular, so many new members of the House who have displayed such courage, who have shown that they truly have the courage of their convictions. Thank you.
Just want to add that one person who isn't with us physically in this room, but I know is present, was present all day for the deliberations, our chair of the Gov Reform, our Oversight Committee chair, our North Star, Elijah Cummings. He said, when the history books are written about this tumultuous era, I want them to show that I was among those in the House of Representatives who stood up to lawlessness and tyranny. He also said, somewhat presciently, when we're dancing with the angels, the question will be, what did you do to make sure we kept our democracy intact? We did all we could, Elijah. We passed the two articles of impeachment. The president is impeached.
Madam Speaker, do you view the House's role in this as complete now? Or are there steps you might take to try to ensure, as the chairman suggested, a more fair trial in the Senate?
You mean more fair trial than they're contemplating? Because we had a very fair process in the House of Representatives. I would yield to our... let me just put it another way. We have legislation approved by the Rules Committee that will enable us to decide how we will send over the articles of impeachment. We cannot name managers until we see what the process is on the Senate side, and I would hope that that will be soon, as we did with our legislation, our Resolution 660, to describe what the process would be. So far, we haven't seen anything that looks fair to us, so hopefully it will be fairer, and when we see what that is, we'll send our managers.
What would you consider a fair trial, Madam Speaker?
We'll make a decision as a group, as we always have, as we go along.
Could you presumably withhold the articles for weeks until you get what you consider a fair trial?
Well, again, we'll decide what that dynamic is, but we hope that the resolution of that process will be soon in the Senate.